So this will be a joint talk with Tai Wu Yan, and yeah, he's also here. So it's, yeah, and yes, I think the setup is the following. So we look at the holomorphic Lambando L over a complex manifold X. So up to now, we don't have any restriction on the manifold. So not necessarily to be Keller or compact. So it's an arbitrary complex manifold. And so phi, but we do assume that the phi is Poisson harmonic. So it's a locally defined weight, so it's Poisson harmonic. And and we also have a we also have a polar function g, which is non-positive on the on x. So g is a globally defined function. So g is a globally defined function. Then we can consider the phi plus lambda g. Yeah, so this also defines a metric on L because G is globally defined. And so we also assume that this is also a Poisson harmonic function. Yeah, so we have two metrics on L. So one is phi and the other one is phi plus lambda G. Yeah, and this is
So
will define the geodesic, the trivial geodesic in the space of metrics. Because if you compute the DDC 2 power of n plus 1, you get 0. It's induced by the flow of the trivial homomorphic red field. So this is a deformation of the original metric. Yeah, but now we can consider the Bergmann projection with respect to this new metric. Yeah, and then we look at the whole throughput, all the Bergmann projections into a single map, and then we denote it by P. This is also mentioned in Varouring's talk. Yes. It's a total Bergmann projection map. Yes, and we want to study the variation of this map. I think this is the setup. But the first thing is, you can see that H is a Hilbert space, and H0 is also a Hilbert space. So it turned out that it's very difficult to plot this theory here, but it's very easy to compute the derivative in the sense of the Hilbert space. So that's observation. That's observation. So you can compute the derivative. And then, so what we are going to do is, we can actually prove that P is smooth. So smooth means that you look at the map between two Hilbert spaces. So this is a smooth map. So this is the result. Yeah, I think we knew this result from Wu. Yeah, and I think it's very interesting because the original proof is to use the regularity theorem of Kong and Hamilton, which is not trivial at all, I think.
You can't use that here anyway, right? You can't use Kong and Hamilton.
Yeah, I mean, in a very special case. Yeah, precisely, yes. Yeah.
We shouldn't think of X as necessarily compact to be allowed.
No, it's only the two can. I think the X is an arbitrary complex manifold.
Sorry, X is?
Arbitrary okay. Complex manifold.
Okay,
yeah.
But X compact would be an interesting case.
Yeah, of course, compact would be the most interesting case. Yeah.
But too easy, would that be too easy for this? Yeah. Mm-hmm. You use much to
But even, I think even in the compact cases, in the compact case it might also not be very easy, yes. Yeah, even when H is here is finite dimensional, but the H is always infinite dimensional, the L2, and this one, this capital H, because it's a projection from it, this is always infinite dimensional. So we are thinking about whether we can prove that this PT depends mostly on T in a Hilbert sense. Yeah, but in any case, the result is true, and the proof is very surprisingly simple. It's actually so you can define this map, and the thing is, if you look at this Bergmann projection map, this is precisely the zero loss of a smooth function of a smooth map. So this smooth map signifies that if you compute the directional derivative with respect to H0, this is an identity map. So you can use the implicit function theorem to prove this. I think it's very interesting. Yeah, you can check that. This is quite trivial, so you can check this directly. I think you can prove this result, which basically, I think it's this proof is due to Wu, a very clever observation, I think. Yeah, because then we can totally avoid the complex, I mean, the very complex regularity theorem. Yeah, so and on the other hand, it's more general, yes. So then the, this is a starting point. Yeah, so once we have this result, then you can imagine that you can do calculus in the Hilbert sense. And then everything would follow very easily. So you can show that we have a Hilbert space, you can think of this as a Bergman space, and then you fix a bounded linear functional on this space, you fix the element of F. And then the Smoothness theorem implies that, and you consider the norm of this functional, now with respect to the t norm, and you think of this as a function of t. So this function, then the Smoothness theorem immediately implies that this functional depends smoothly on the parameter t. So here the point is f is fixed, so only the norm change. Because it's a family of Hilbert norms defined on the same Hilbert space, only the norm change. Yeah, so this is the definition of the norm of our operator. Yeah. So we can prove that it's smooth, and then you can compute the variation of this norm. So it will give you some curvature formula. Computer variation or not. The result, I think that this result is proved by Fourier. So when you compute the curvature, one part comes from the O2 bundle, and the other part comes from the second fundamental form. And we can use the Hohmann O2 estimate to control the second fundamental form. This is also a Booth idea, I think. So in that case, once you have a Hohmann L2 estimate, Hohmann L2 type estimate, then you can prove the certain convexity. So you compute, you take the log, and then you compute the second order derivative where you have to.
How do you do that for a quasi
carrier? Yeah.
Strictly PSA.
Yeah. That's a good question. Yes, that's a because you first solve the Laplacian equation, and then you want to see that okay, the Laplacian equation will reduce to the Debye equation, and then you need a family of cutoff functions. And the original definition of complete carrier is we have a family of cutoff functions, let's say Gj, and then the part that is equal to 1. Eventually, we'll cover the whole space X, and then but the gradient will go to the Shukri one is smaller than F and J will go to zero. Yeah. The gradient is arbitrarily small when J goes to infinity, and the part that is equal to 1 will go to eventually this set will go to the whole space X. So this is the definition. But now the quasi complete carrier, you can actually introduce a deformation. You can change omega to omega j, such as omega j is the decreasing limit is equal to omega. So this is the definition for quasi complete carrier. Yeah, but the advantage is because here the metric is not smooth. When you're solving Debye equation, you need to use the Debye approximation to regularize. To regularize the singular metric. Yes? Yeah, but then you only get a smooth metric outside the analytic subset on each step. So you have to really need that, you really need to consider the complete carrier, the complement, the theoretically open set of the complete carrier. But this is in general not complete color. Obviously, we cannot prove that it's complete color. Yeah, I guess it's quite difficult to prove. Yeah, but if you look at, if you adjust the definition of complete color, which is a more general definition, and then so we call this as quasi-complete color, then you can easily show that if X is quasi-complete color, then the Cauchy open set is also quasi-complete color. It's stable when you take the Cauchy open set. Yeah. Yeah, I can explain to you later, but it's not elementary, I think. Yeah. Mm.
Okay, so I have a very basic question. I just because I'm a bit lost in the definition of how it. So you have a family of metrics depending on T.
Depending on T, that's
me. And do they have curves of harmonic? Are they curves of harmonic in all variables in this case?
Yeah, that's a good question. Yes, exactly. Because we have this assumption, now you go back to the, because the derivative is controlled by, is from 0 to lambda. So this combination is sort of, certain kind of combination of phi, is between phi and phi plus lambda g. Yeah, so it's a positive combination. And you can compute the,
So it is
for example, with respect to the z.
So this is idea. I think it's appearing.
is zero, and you let g, you let the constant lambda go to infinity, and then you can prove a certain orthogonal Hilbert type theorem. Yes. And also, yeah, and also when x is compact, you can use the spectral theorem and the matrix reduction trick also by Bu. You can also get this degeneration theorem, which is in a long number of paper, long number and vector bundles paper. So this is, I think, I will mention this really loud. Yeah. But our proof is, it's, and then people ask that whether you can prove this result when x is not necessarily compact, and even in the case of x is uniball. Because if you can prove this, then you give a very quick proof of the Swan-Hopkins result with sharp estimate. If you can prove this, then you can prove the uniball case for arbitrary u, you get the Swan-Hopkins result with sharp estimate. But your question is to prove that using the Hilbert bundle analysis things. But we cannot do that. But we can use Hoffman the alpha estimate to prove a big version. And then we can get that e to minus 1 plus epsilon t, this is decreasing. And then we can have epsilon equal to 0, we can get the original. Yeah, so we cheat a little bit. We don't really do Hilbert analysis. And we can use Hoffman to do that. So this is,
what's the conclusion on that? You get this from open that way, or?
Yeah. So do you let epsilon go to zero? Yeah. So this is the next page.
Yeah.
So you can get a sharp, Swan-Hopkins type of result. Yes. Yeah. So you can consider general f. So here, also x is arbitrary, and you can estimate the. You can estimate the integrability index. So the integrability index with regard to so here I phi plus alpha g means the it means L2 with regard to the E2 minus phi plus alpha g in the neighborhood of K. So then you can define the integrability index. I think when k is equal to x, this index is also mentioned in Thomas' talk, yes. So the k is actually equal to x. And so many things when k is a point. And then you can easily get one directly from the estimate. Yeah. So that's so that's one thing. And in case if g itself is raised up harmonic, you can let the lambda go to infinity, and then you can get the previous result proved by Guan, proved by Qian Guan. Yeah. So of course the Swan-Hopkins is itself due to Guanzhou, and also, we have a lot of experts here, Matthias. Yeah, so it's for the openness things. And yes, I think this is the first application. And and the other one is that I want to mention is the Osawa-Taihoshi type result. So because it's decreasing, and you can simply compute the limit. I wouldn't say that a trivial one, you can get such estimate from basically you estimate the sub level set and you rewrite the integral you can get this. Yeah. So how to integrate this result? It means that if you have a holomorphic expression over the support of this quotient shift. Yeah, so you can think, you can, how to think, how to look at this. So if V is smooth, and G is kind of multiple, this is precisely the reflection to the minus infinity box of G. And so if we have a harmonic section here, and we want to look at the L2 minimal theorem without this assumption. So we really need to assume that, of course, if it has a Stein-Tarrasch open set, then of course you can't prove that. But in general, we don't know how to do that. So, I'm not very sure that this is the right question to ask or not. But we think it might be possible to use the Hilbert bundle approach to also prove the existence of the extension. And the possible theorem will be probably this one. This is a result that has already been proved by first by Damai and then by Chao Damai Matsumura a few years ago. And then the most general version is due to Zhou and Zhu. So the result is if X is, if there is a proper holomorphic mapping to Cn, so X in total space of operation over Stein. Over a Stein variety, over a Stein space, proper fabrication over a Stein space, and then we actually have the extension result, especially when Q is equal to zero, this is you can think of this as extension result, because this is subjective. If you have a section here, and then you can have a list. That vibration is just a holomorphic mapping. It's no submersion.
Close inversion.
Close.
For example, when X is a hyperplane in CN, then also included there.
X is a hyperplane in CN.
Yeah.
Then is of course true because it's Stein. Then you look at the trivial map to embed into CN. Then it's definitely true. This is I think this is a very nice result. So the question is whether we can use the Hilbert bundle approach to prove this result, and we don't know how to do that.
That would be for Q equals zero.
I think the most interesting case would be the Q equal to zero case. So, I will stop.